because cannabis was a reasonably good source of tryptamines, and that was the first one made commercially available. In Australia, they've used acacia leaves and bark of two different species, acacia medidenii and acacia phlebophylla, also legumes in the family leguminosae. But what we basically, phalaris grass also, a number of wild grasses contain tryptamines, and all European ayahuasca ones have been made by Giorgio Sammartini using a strain from northern Italy of phalaris grass as tryptamine source. So basically, a number of things have been tried, but the market has seemingly settled on Jurema or Jurema preta, Mimosa tenuiflora. We're lucky enough to actually have a live plant here that you can come up and look at later. And that's what I'm going to talk about for the rest of my lecture. And you saw a little illustration of it there. And I want to go back, and this is also another page from Christian's book, the Encyclopedia of Psychoactive Plants. He also specifically singles out this plant, Mimosa tenuiflora. It's known widely in literature as Mimosa hostilis, but the correct name is tenuiflora. And he singles this out as a particularly good species for making ayahuasca animals, or what he calls Jordan ayahuasca or Mimosa ayahuasca. And also in Trout's book, that he also does the same thing. He singles out the Jordan and has a special section on that. And as I say, it's become really the standard of importance for making ayahuasca animals. So here you see illustrated what would be a basic dose of ayahuasca using the Jordana bark. This is brood bark of the Mimosa tenuiflora, and we'll talk in more detail about that in a moment. 10 grams of brood bark, and then 3 grams of Paganum harmala seed, or harmala seed. And so the harmala seed is the analog of the stem of ayahuasca, because it contains 10 times more beta-carbenes normally than ayahuasca stem does. So from my perspective as a chemist, it's actually a better source, practically speaking, of these alkaloids than this, and it happens to be an almost leafless shrub that grows in very arid areas. It's different ecologically and anatomically from Vanus caryopsis as possible, but it turns out to be a very good source, and it's legally and cheaply available all over the world, and that's become the de facto standard. 3 grams of that is normally enough, although some people need more, and there will be strain variation. So for me, this is a good dose of an analog. You make the aqueous infusion with 10 grams of the root bark crushed up and 3 grams of the seeds crushed up in a little blender. And there are recipes published in my book in other areas, but I'll just say briefly, you make an aqueous extract. I add a little lemon juice to facilitate the extraction of the alkaloids. And for me, it has to be something you can do with minimal amount of energy in 15 or 20 minutes, or it's some way effective as far as these animals, because there's no need to boil the thing all day and uses a lot of energy. So this is fairly instantly in your own home, you can make an ayahuasca analog. And as I say, legally, because both of these are legally available. The Jordana preta bark happens to have another name in Mexico. It's called Tabasco Huite. And there it's probably the most famous Mexican ethnomedicine of all. But it's not drunk, it's put on burns on your skin, and you make soaps and shampoos out of it. And so it's even sold legally under that name in the United States. But it happens to be a very good source of DMT. The empirical formula he gave for it doesn't really jive exactly with DMT, but some years ago, it contained tryptamines. And it has a very